Hello and welcome to another Kubla Cubed tutorial. In this one we're going to have a look at one of the first things that people get a bit confused about with Kubla Cubed, and that's the construction phases and the calculation order, the nature in which sort of Kubla Cubed combines different elements together to create a single proposed surface, because that's quite different to other programs that people have used. So we'll start by looking at the construction phases that appear as sort of tabs down the bottom here. And they're probably easier to understand. What they are is the result of one phase goes into the source surface of the next, or the ground surface of the next. So we start off with the existing one. We've defined that with the surface here. So that's quite easy to understand. Now the next phase starts with that existing surface as the source surface, and then we define a proposed surface using elements down here. So in this one we've defined this kind of car parking example with four ponds in it. So this is where it gets a bit different to some of the programs, or a feature you might not see in other programs. When you click on the next phase, you'll find that the ground in this phase is the proposed in the previous one. Starting from scratch, it's got no cut and fill volume, so it's ready for you to do work on another area of the project. So this is quite a powerful feature and allows you to do things like topsoil strip calculations, backfilling. In those two examples, say, in the strip example, you need to strip down in one phase, and then in the next phase, you need to build up to your subgrade levels. And in the third phase, you might build up to then materials. So you can use the phases to break down different layers of earthworks, or you can use it to break down different time of earthworks if you've got earthworks being done at different times. So it's quite flexible. It's not necessary for just one use, but it can be used in a lot of different ways. For example, in this one, we might choose to fill back up those ponds with material. So to simply do that, I'll just draw a platform over the top and set the level to this level here. So it's 128, 1.5. So the earthworks in this phase will just report the volume of that fill operation. It won't report anything related to the cut and fill here, that's for that phase. Instead it will calculate the fill of this phase only. So to create new phases it's quite simple, you just click on the plus symbol. So what we're going to do here is add a strip phase, so I just add a new one. You can rename them as well, so I'll rename it strip. If you have got a strip, it's usually the one straight after existing. So I'm going to move that to the left, and then I'm going to move it to the left again. So what I'm going to do here is I've got my existing, and then on the strip phase, I'm going to do a strip over most of the site. And then one thing that will be interesting about this is that I don't need to worry about these phase one and propose two, because the calculations will automatically trickle down. If you make amendments to either the existing or a phase further up in the order, it will automatically detect that changes have been made and recalculate the subsequent phases. So in here I've dropped the entire surface down by a foot. Now we'll find in phase one that foot drop is being taken into the calculations. So you can see here it's recalculating and it's resulted in more fill, and this one also. So it's worth playing around with the phases. It's a really powerful feature. Experimenting with things that, like calculating topsoil strips and then building back up, or building up material layers. So I'll do a quick example here. So if I wanted to do another one and calculate a material layer, I might put a spread over a specific area where I was building up the material. And then that phase could be used just for that calculation to calculate that material. And you can create as many as you need. So to recap, I'll use this diagram. So we've got here what I've been talking about. We've got the existing phase, and then the next one on, the proposed phase, which has got the existing and then a proposed earthworks. And then from that it can do cut and fill calculations. The existing can't do any cut and fill calculations because it doesn't have two surfaces. All the rest just have two surfaces, a ground or existing level, and then a design or proposed level, whatever you want to call it. So the important thing to remember here is that there's only two surfaces per phase, and that feeds into what we'll talk about next, which is calculation order. The easiest way to demonstrate the concept of how Kubla Cubed works in context of the calculation order is if you draw two platforms intersecting. So you've got one platform there at 1285.80, and then we'll draw another platform quite a lot higher up over here. And we'll set that to 189, so it's quite higher than the other one. Now, what is happening here is it's not the case that platform one is calculated the cut and fill and then platform two is calculated the cut and fill. What happens is these two objects are combined into a single proposed surface, which is why I was saying previously it's important to remember there's only two surfaces per phase. Once you've got that into your mind, it makes sense that these two are combined into one. And in the area that they intersect, one of them takes precedence. Now, to the question as to which one takes precedence, that's where the calculation order comes in. So in this case, platform two is lower down in the order. So platform one gets calculated first, triangulated, that is, and then platform two is merged into platform one, and it keeps going. If there was platform three, that would be merged into the group. And then the cut and fill is done at the end of that merge. So in this case, we've got platform two underneath platform one in the calculation order. But if we switch the order around, you can see that the precedence changes. It creates a very different surface. So you can start, like, as an example, you can build up quite complicated earthworks by using these techniques of combining different stuff together. But that's a sort of topic for another video of like how you can add different elements together to get different effects. I mean, that's quite a complicated surface, but I've just done it by combining all these together. So what you should be visualizing here is a single ground surface, a single proposed surface, and then the cut and fill happening at the end. And if you hover the mouse over, that confirms that. There's not several different proposed levels. There's only one proposed level, one existing level, and that's how the calculations are done. This is an area of confusion for people when they first start, so that's why it's really important. And understand the difference between, if these elements were defined in different phases, they would have a different set of cut and fill calculations, because rather than being combined, they'd be calculated separately. So if we go into this phase, right now you can see that the result of the previous phase, the proposed from the previous phase, has become this phase. But if we did, for example, like take this element at the bottom here and copied and pasted it from this phase into the next phase down, this will result in different cut and fill calculations, because in this phase, instead of that design surface having a gap there, it's now been built up to this platform. And in the next phase, it's then been cut out of by this platform. Whereas in the previous example, that wouldn't happen. This would have been the level that it was built up to. And there would be no deep cut into this one. You have to play around with this and sort of understand these concepts. Elements combined together in a phase, if they were separated into subsequent phases, they effectively become separate operations. So far we've been looking at the platform element, which has an explicit elevation, and the same is true for the slope element, the feature surface and the triangle surface, and the path surface with certain settings. Now, the strip and the spread, they don't actually have an explicit elevation. They have an additive or subtractive like operation. The strip reduces the level and the spread raises the level. And so if I, for example, draw a strip over this, you'll see that it will raise up the whole elevation of the surface in that area by a set amount, so you can see the effect of that. Now, if I put it underneath one of the platforms, you'll see it has no effect on that. That platform will overwrite that strip. And as I go up, the spread continues to get overwritten by the other elements. And so at this point, it's completely redundant. So it's important to kind of look in the 3D to see the effect of what's happening, because it's quite easy to make mistakes with the order and not realize that an element that you've created is having no impact because it's being overwritten by another element. The same is true of the strip. If we take a strip and draw that over this area, then it will strip from the that platform. If we move it above that platform, it will have no effect. So to finish up, we'll just have a look at another example. We'll just play around with a few things just to demonstrate some of the things we've been looking at. So in this project, what we've got is a existing surface that we've taken off. There's no cut and fill in this one. The existing is just for defining the existing topography. In the next one, we've done a site strip in its own phase. Site strips are almost always in their own phase. And we've dropped that down by, I'll change that to make it kind of obvious in the view, half a foot, so 6 inches. So, and then in the next phase, we want to do the proposed elevations. And you can see the that site strip in the existing there. You can see where that's come through. And then we've built, with a single feature surface, we've got contour lines over the top. So there's a few different ways that we can use the things that we've learned about calculation order to adjust this surface if we want to. So the first one, a quite common approach, is to draw strips over the top of the proposed levels to adjust to a subgrade. So I'll draw a strip over, say, this purple area, a section of this purple area, just to demonstrate that. So there's another whole video talking about this concept, but what this will do is it will, because the strip and the proposed ones are in the same phase, the proposed elevations will be dropped down by 0.5 in that area. And that technique is used to adjust to a subgrade or formation level, it's sometimes called. There's another video that talks about that. So let's try a few other things. Well, this platform has been defined by contours in the feature surface. So we'll draw another platform over the top. We'll overwrite that area with another platform, which is a bit higher up. And because the platform element generates side slopes, it'll be a lot, it'll have a much more crisper outline and look better in the 3D. So this is just playing around really, but it gives you an idea about what's possible. Now this shows us something interesting about the calculation order. That strip is being overwritten by the platform, but what if we wanted the strip to actually act on the platform as well? What if, for instance, that we stretch this strip out so it goes over the platform and the feature surface? Now, at the moment, because it's in the middle of the two, it will be acting on the feature surface, but it won't be acting on the platform. So if we just move it underneath the platform in the calculation order, you can see now see that strip is acting on both the platform and the feature surface. So let's finish by doing another modification. So this is one way that you can use these tools, not only from designing stuff from scratch, but making slight modifications to a design that you've taken off from contours or points, but you want to improve it or modify some of the design. Okay, the final thing that we're going to do is use the slope element to create a little ramp in this, an access ramp down into this oil storage tank. So to do that, I just add a slope over that section. And there you go, there's a little ramp there. So this kind of like method of building up a proposed surface using lots of different elements is probably unfamiliar to someone who's more used to doing a takeoff of contour lines and points. And you might want to just stick to what you know initially and use the takeoff tools and use the strips, for instance, to adjust to a subgrade, but not use too many of these other techniques. But it's useful to know that they're there if you do want to experiment, and especially on a small scale where you might want to do a platform and then a ramp going down and then another platform. And it's far easier to do it with this method than it is to design loads of different contours. So that brings us to the end of the video. As usual, if there's any questions about this, if you post on our forums or on the comments below, we're happy to reply. This is another quite complicated subject, so I would definitely recommend playing around with it, viewing your models in 3D, and using the cursor to check the existing and proposed. And keep in mind the sort of golden rules are that there's only two surfaces, an existing and proposed, per phase, and the result of a previous phase is fed into the existing of the next.